Hey guys, I'm trying to see what factors influence my HRV by running a series of 7-day experiments and measuring the effect. First though, what is HRV? It stands for heart rate variability, and it is simply the variation in time between your heartbeats. You might think having a low HRV is a good thing, meaning your heart runs almost like clockwork, but generally it's better to have a higher HRV. It shows that your body is primed to adapt to whatever you're going to throw at it that day. The other thing to understand is the autonomic nervous system, in particular two parts of it, the sympathetic nervous system, known as the fight or flight, and the parasympathetic nervous system, often referred to as the rest and digest. Both have their uses. If you need to get fired up for a workout, you want to engage the sympathetic, and if you're sitting down for a meal or winding down for bed, then you want to activate the parasympathetic. To obtain a higher HRV in the short term, you typically want to focus more on activities for the parasympathetic system. So how am I measuring HRV? I have an Aura sleep tracking ring that measures a number of different metrics each night, and one of those is average HRV. If you're only able to take a daytime measurement, then the best thing to do is to do that seated in the morning and for the same duration each time, typically 3 to 5 minutes. Since HRV has a genetic component, it isn't directly comparable across individuals, but it is a good way to assess trends in your own health. It's more important to consider HRV relative to your own baseline. So 80 might be a really good score for me, but it might be below average for a friend if he's an elite athlete. There are other biological factors, including age and gender. Here's a graph showing the middle 50% of HRV values. You can see a decline with age and also slightly lower values for women. I'm 35, so the middle 50% for my age and gender looks to be about 40 to 75 milliseconds. Two of the biggest lifestyle factors are alcohol consumption and stress. Most people with a wearable will tell you how horrendous their metrics look the morning after drinking, and chronic stress can keep you in that sympathetic fight or flight mode for extended periods of time. Another lifestyle factor is diet, and this study found that a healthy intake of omega-3 and B vitamins increased HRV, while lots of saturated fats and high GI carbohydrates lowered it. There's also circadian rhythm, that's your body's internal clock, which can be helped with things like morning sun exposure, avoiding artificial light before bed, and consistent meal timing. In terms of exercise, large increases in exercise volume or intensity, as well as doing something that your body isn't used to, can lead to a short-term drop in HRV. So let's dive into my own data. My Aura ring arrived in April last year, and the first 365 days of HRV data looked like this. I'll start with a histogram. You can see most of the time my HRV falls between 58 and 80 milliseconds. My lowest of the year was 34 and my highest was 106. The 34 was back in March. I was in the middle of changing jobs. Earlier that day, I'd been emailed an outline for this daunting 4-stage interview process, which left me very stressed. The 106 was on holiday, and that evening I spent at least half an hour at a spa doing rounds of sauna and cold water immersion. Moving on to a scatter plot, this horizontal line represents my average, which has been 67.7. Some of you might have spotted a few patterns here, so I'll just colour in two periods of the last year. The first is 7 weeks in Lithuania last summer, and the second is the month when I was changing jobs. So for me, it seems like periods of high and low mental stress come through clearest in HRV. With that in mind, I'll move on to the 7-day experiments. For this, I picked one focus area for each 7-day period, either something in the research or anecdotes on forums has said positively or negatively influences HRV. I tried to keep all the other variables the same, which as you can imagine is tough when you don't know exactly what it is that influences your HRV. So time-restricted feeding, which I'm familiar with through Dr. Sachin Panda's book, The Circadian Code, means consuming all your calories within a 10 or 11 hour window. Coherent breathing is between 4 and 7 breaths per minute. I ended up doing 10 minutes a day for 2 weeks. I chose 5 seconds in and 6 seconds out, which is around 5.5 breaths per minute. Then I had a week off work, which I coupled with a reduction in training intensity and volume. That was followed by cold water immersion, 10 minutes every day, either in the morning or after the day's workout, using water around 14 degrees, with the recommendation being no higher than 15. If you try this, it's worth having someone standing by the first few times, as you can go into shock if the water is too cold for you. After that, I had a higher stress week. I was starting a new job, which involved a long commute and a new shift pattern. Then mouth taping, it's exactly what it sounds like, surgical tape across the middle third of my mouth to encourage nasal breathing at night. ZMA is zinc and magnesium, and I usually take 2 pills every night. To me, the pills feel like the equivalent to an extra half hour sleep, so the expectation was that without them, I would have a lower HRV. Finally, hydration. First, I tracked my water intake for a week. I was actually surprised to see that I'm about a litre a day below the recommendations, so for this week, I tried averaging 2.5 litres each day. Since planning these experiments, I've been improving my knowledge of HRV, mainly thanks to the Whoop podcast and the wonderful Emily Capitalupo. At first, I thought the goal of HRV was to maintain this consistent streak of really high scores, so trying to get each day up in the high 60s, 70s, or even higher. In reality, with exercise, there are going to be ups and downs, and that's actually a good thing. A healthier HRV could be one that has more day-to-day variation. Ideally, those low scores would fall the night before a recovery day, and high scores before important training sessions, competitions, or even non-exercise related activities where you need to be mentally sharp for a meeting or a presentation. HRV is closely tied to cardiovascular fitness, so improvements there should come through in your HRV. That's why my experiments weren't set up ideally. I could take cold water immersion and do that every day for a year and then move my baseline 3 or 4 milliseconds up. Or I could go and train hard, accept that temporary dip, and over the long term, just move my baseline up. Okay, so what are my next steps? This systematic review found that higher training intensities and frequencies are more likely to improve HRV in the long term. That's backed up by Whoop, who found that it's better to have more variation in your training intensity across a given week. So rather than planning 5 to 7 moderate sessions, you should go for several hard days and then make the other ones noticeably easier. I feel like daily cold exposure is part of a good routine and has a noticeable benefit to my stress levels, so that should be included somewhere. Whoop are big on sleep consistency, so I've been setting a bedtime alarm about 45 minutes before I sleep, which prompts me to darken the room, stop using screens. I also now drift off to a sleep meditation. In terms of diet, I briefly tried lower carb, but I inadvertently selected a very high fiber meal for dinner, which meant I was still full getting into bed, and that reduced my HRV. So the only consideration I make food-wise would be to leave a big enough gap between dinner and bedtime and to definitely eliminate all late night snacking. If you've tried to improve your own HRV, I'd love to hear what worked for you. Hopefully you found my insights useful, and as always, thank you for watching.